Hello everyone, my name is Ever Barbero, and today I'd like to talk about example 6.4 in my textbook, Finite Element Analysis of Composite Materials Using Abacus. This example is about computational micromechanics. Take a minute to orient yourself. The blue triad at the center of the representative volume element shows the directions, 1 along the fiber, 2 to the right, and 3 up. We have a representative volume element with two carbon fibers embedded into a block of epoxy matrix. One of the fibers is split into 4 quarters. The dimensions of the RVE are labeled according to the 1-2-3 axes, shown by the blue triad at the center of the RVE. We want to apply some strains and be able to calculate the maximum stress in the matrix and the average stress in the RVE. The average stress can be used in a local global analysis. We calculate everything exactly at the local level. Then we pass the average stresses back to the global, macro level. Here we are applying an in-plane strain, epsilon 2, see the red arrow along the 2 direction, and shear strain, gamma 23, also in red color. Computational micromechanics requires that we apply periodicity conditions to all the sides of the RVE, so that the simulation is accurate for the whole material surrounding the RVE. In previous examples, we were able to satisfy periodicity by applying either symmetry boundary conditions, or using tie constraints. In this example, we cannot apply tie constraints, because the strain epsilon 2 will stretch the RVE, in effect separating the two faces that, if tied, would not be able to separate from each other. Symmetry boundary conditions cannot be used either, because the shear deformation applied is not symmetric. In other words, due to the applied shear, the RVE will tilt to the right, invalidating any symmetry conditions that we might try to apply. In fact, the RVE will tilt to the right, and upward, like this. Thus, symmetry boundary conditions are out of the question. Since we can't use symmetry or tie constraints, then we use constraint equations, CE. These are equations that bind the displacement of pairs of nodes on opposite faces of the RVE, and may include a constant term, that represents the applied strain, as it is explained in the textbook. For this example, the fiber direction strain epsilon 1, and the shear strains gamma 1-2 and gamma 1-3 are 0. That allows us to reduce the domain from 3D to 2D, applying periodicity on the front and back faces, using 2D plane strain elements. And if epsilon 1 were different from 0, we could use 2D generalized plane strain elements. Next, we could build the model in CAE, in the same way we have done so many times in most videos published so far, but today I want to use a different method. I want to use a combination of CAE and Python script. In preparation for this video, I used CAE as usual, stopping along the way, to harvest the Python code that CAE writes into the rec file, and assembling that code into a Python script, called ex6.4.py. Next, I will show you the resulting Python script, module by module, and I will show you what it does when I run it in CAE. First, we set the work directory. The Python code is in these files: pbc2d.py, srecover2d.py, and ex6.4.py. We shall start with ex6.4.py. Next, I show you each snippet of code and how I use it in CAE. Here we import the modules that we need. How do I know what to write here? That's easy. As soon as I open up CAE, I go look what was written in the rec and RPY files, and I copy that to my script file, ex6.4.py. Then, copy paste to the Python shell inside CAE. As soon as it is pasted, with Ctrl V, it is executed. Besides a copy of the script pasted, the Python shell shows what was done. In this case, a new model database and a new model, Model 1, were created. Here we manually add our own Python code to define parameters that control the model. In this way, we can later run the script with different geometry, different properties, different mesh density, whatever you want. We can verify if our variables were actually incorporated to the current session in CAE. Just type the name of some variable to see its value printed at the Python prompt. This is the code to create a part. To write this code, I use CAE, select module part, then on the top menu, click part, click create. Then open the .rec file, and copy the code to your script file. Nothing shows here, because we haven't done the sketch yet. In preparation for this video, I did the sketch with CAE, and captured this code, and now I use it. Everything is there. In module property, create materials for the fiber and the matrix. Now we create sections for the fiber and the matrix. Now we assign the sections to regions in the part. To write constraint equations, we need sets for faces and vertices, named in a very specific way, so that we can use those names later in our constraint equations code. And here they are. Here we create an instance of the part. Now we mesh. Notice how the mesh, and everything else, is parameterized in terms of the parameters that we defined earlier. As usual, we need a step. To compute average stress, we need the volume of each element, so we edit the field output request to save IVOL. To write the constraint equations, we wrote a separate script, called pbc2d.py. This time it is a Python script written manually, from scratch. And here it is. You can download it and study it. Basically, it writes the constraint equations, exactly as they are written in section 6.3 of the textbook, but it uses the names of the faces and vertices to identify the nodes. The reference point, RP, is necessary to write constraint equations. The boundary condition BC1, applied to RP, specifying U1 equals 1, is not applying a displacement to anything. It is just a requirement of the process to write constraint equations. In module interaction, we can see all of the constraint equations written. Obviously, this is not something that you want to do manually, thus, we do it with a Python script. As usual, we need to define a job. Once we do it, we can either click submit in CAE, or use the equivalent Python code, shown here. We can calculate results with an external script, or visualize the results in the usual way, by clicking Results on the job window, to go to the Visualization module. The applied strain produces a complex field of stress and strain inside the RVE, at the micro scale. The average stress and strain describes an equivalent, homogeneous material, at the meso scale. To calculate it, we use another script, called srecover2d.py. The script srecover2d.py returns the average stress and average strain at any time you specify with the frame number I. You can go to module visualization, either by clicking results in the job window, or by using the equivalent statement in the Python script. A complex stress field at the micro scale can be represented by a single value of average stress at the meso scale. To appreciate the deformation, we use options, common, basic, to increase the deformation scale factor. Note how the constraint equations maintain parallel, identical shapes on all pairs of edges. Note how E33 is equal to 0, as it should be due to the plane strain condition. Okay, that's it for today. If you liked this video, don't forget to subscribe. You can find more details in the textbook by following the link in the description. Thank you.